Hello everybody and welcome to the 12th virtual event by IntelliGnis for today's Business Intelligence and Analytics Summit. So thank you very much for everyone who's joining. Obviously, the aim of the event is to provide a platform for all of our participants to network, gain insights and explore innovative technologies that can redefine their business strategy and culture. So before we get going, a few shout outs. Shout out to our platinum sponsor, Metric Insights. Obviously, my name, Kyle Winterbottom, I'm going to host and moderate today, and I'm the CEO and founder of our Bishan Group, and we are delighted to be the community partner for today's event. And we need to give a shout out to our media partners, Inside Telecom, Financial IT, and the AI Time Journal. So we're going to get going. Obviously, this show is being recorded, so we're expecting a fair amount of people here. But if not, then people can catch up, and the IntelliGnis team will be able to share the recordings after the event. I guess just some general housekeeping. Each session is going to last roughly 20 minutes or so, with 5 minutes left at the end for a kind of Q&A. And then there's going to be a bit of a 10-minute kind of networking break in between that. And we've got a total of 10 sessions. So for everybody that's here today and watching, I urge you to kind of get your questions in ahead of time. Obviously, I'll do my best to get these questions posed to the panel and get the speakers answering as many of your questions as we possibly can. So get your questions coming in as they're speaking and we'll get them addressed at the end. So to kick us off, session number one, we have Tomas Arteaga from Deutsche Bank. Tomas, I hope I pronounced that right and I didn't butcher your name. Apologies if so.
It's fine.
But, good. Okay. Yeah. Probably like me, you get used to just kind of taking what everyone calls you. So I've been on Kyle, Kelly, Kylie, something like that. But anyway, Tomas, I'm never going to be able to do your introduction the justice that it deserves. So what I want to do is kind of give you a kind of 30-second spiel to kind of give yourself a brief introduction into your background, who you are, what you do, where you work, and then fire straight into your session, if you'd be so kind.
Yeah, perfect. Thank you very much, Kyle, I suppose. I hope I pronounce it well, your name as well. I'm Tomas Arteaga, and I've been working for Deutsche Bank for the last 12 years. Currently, well, I've been working for Deutsche Bank in the division of IPB. In the past, I've been working as consultant, and also I work for BBVA, a big bank in Spain. I work for IPB division. IPB is International Private Bank, and this is related with retail banking plus kind of commercial banking plus wealth management. So composed of all of these businesses. This is a mix. Well, the businesses were mixed 2 years ago or so, the wealth management with the retail, more retail banking. And in Deutsche Bank, I have taken in the past several roles. First was a customer analytics manager, and for the last 4 years I've been working more related with data science and kind of digital campaigns. I was working that in the past, and since 2020 I am focusing data science and analytics, and also belonging to a center of expertise. That means that we are working together with some other data scientist teams along IPB Deutsche Bank. These teams are located in different places like Frankfurt, Singapore, UK, US, Italy, Belgium, some other locations. And that's all by the moment. I think we can start.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, a very illustrious career so far. So, yeah, please fire away. I'm looking forward to the topic, real-time analytics in banking. So, yeah, please take it away.
Let me share. I think you can see my screen.
Yep.
Well, as I mentioned previously, this is international private bank. That means that this is related to retail banking and wealth management mainly. So what we are going to see is more related with this kind of businesses, more related with retail. Well, we have seen in the last years a big explosion, let's say, of data, what we call data revolution. And this data revolution is enabling in retail banking mainly and private banking different kind of solutions, more related with new services. We have seen robo-advisors, new banks, personal finance managers. We are also seeing how this data and artificial intelligence tools are helping in the digitalizations of processes. This means internal processes and also processes more related with customers. I mean, this could be, for example, the digital onboarding. You can sign, you can become client just using your iPhone or your mobile phone, or you can ask for a loan and get the loan also by your iPhone. This is kind of digitalization processes that are more related with the front end of the customer. And also this digitalization process has a lot to do with the marketing tools. We have been able to automate the responses, automate the customer campaigns and so on via this artificial intelligence, via this data that we have available. And also another point that I think is very important to these solutions related with data and artificial intelligence is the customer experience. Right now we have a lot of ways to interact with customers, and for banks that have been working for a long time ago, like Deutsche Bank, for example, we have the challenge to integrate all these channels. I mean, the main channel has been always the advisor, but we have to integrate other kind of channels like push notifications, emailing, the web, the application, and so on. And we have to orchestrate all of them and to make all the conversations significant. And we have to make all the channels to be integrated between them. The conversation have to can start in advisor, can go on via email. You can use push notification, but all the communications, all the messages have to be relevant. And this has been enabled via big data platforms, via artificial intelligence, also via artificial intelligence platforms, and real time is also helping to achieve these objectives and to implement these solutions. From our side, from the Deutsche Bank point of view, we have a clear strategy related with digital and private banking. We try to get the best from both worlds, from one side in digital banking, to have these capabilities like omnichannel, real-time, interactive, user experience, customer launches, the convenience of the messages, but also we have to take advantage of our personal advisor. This is a high valued and reliable advisory, mobility and high skilled personal advisor. Our customers appreciate a lot this personal advisor. They appreciate a lot the relation with the advisor, but we are also giving them solutions in the digital side. So there are some kind of transactions they can do digitally, and there are some other kind of transactions that they have to do via our private banking advisor. But we have the challenge to mix all of these to give our customers the best customer experience. Okay, taking this into account, several years ago we launched what we call Next Best Action, that the proposal of this solution is based on analytics, offer the most suitable content to our clients through the most appropriate channel and turn every interaction into a personalized customer experience. This happened some years ago. What we are doing now, from the last 2 years, what we are doing is to have it also in real time. So we are introducing real time in all this process, trying to serve the best content, the best message, the best offer to our customers also in real time. First, also, I would like to give some insights about real-time and real-time decisioning, what is helping to to this, what we need to consider to do so. Here's what we call the four cornerstones capabilities of real-time decisions. You have to take into account these four cornerstones in order to define these real-time processes, these real-time solutions. First of all, we have to speak about detection. This is this has to be with the identifying the process that are going to trigger or they are susceptible to trigger a message to our customers. Here we can find several types of events, simple events, non-events. This means that we expect to have an event and the event finally didn't happen. So this could also trigger a message, a communication with the customer. And also complex events. That means that could mix or could compound an event of made of different events. If event A happens and event B happens as well, we can trigger event C, let's say. Another cornerstone, another capability that we need to consider is related with data. At Deutsche Bank, we are working at this moment for these real-time processes with transactional data, and we have aimed to add some other data. I mean, transactional data as the trigger for the communication. So we need to, we're going to see later. We are going to read from our host system, detect the event, and after that, and process that, we could trigger the message. When we speak about data and when we speak about events, we need to consider the context. We can define five kinds of context, more environmental. That means that we have to consider that the customer location, where is the customer right now, not only physically, but digitally. Behavioral, the customer is doing something, the customer have just done something. This is more the focus that we have right now, that is more related with the events that are happening in the with the transactional data. Translated into more simple information, this could be a payment with your credit card or money transfer that you are doing with your current account. More emotional, this could be another kind of context. This has to be with the sentiment of our customer. Motivational, what the customer wants to do, or situational, that if the customer wants to, is in the meantime of the process, is at the stage of the process, so we can hear trigger also some messages to make the customer go on in the process. That is, for example, when in the onboarding, in the digital onboarding, the customer has get stuck or maybe abandoned the process. So we can trigger messages to try to make the customer go on with the process. But this real-time process that we are going to see today is more related with behavioral, and also we have some use cases, but they are not totally developed by the moment, more related with environmental. But we also have some other use cases not so well defined for the other kind of context. The third capability we need to consider is decision. This is the way you combine the information, the way you apply rules to trigger or not to trigger the message, or to decide which message we are going to send to the customer. The basic level is just deterministic rules. If the event happens, just send this to the customer. Of if the event happens, and also and the customer has a credit line and so on, we send the message. If the customer hasn't got that credit line, we don't send the message. This could be a deterministic rule. And here we can add also some kind of more complex analytical rules or even though analytical models or predictive models. In our model that we're going to see today, is, I could say it's a mix between level 2 and 3. We are applying some predictive models, but we are not yet, let's say, applying this, what here calls time adaptative. The fourth capability is related with delivery. This is the time that the message is sent or takes the message to send to the customer. This depending on where we are using it, the digital asset that we are using, the time is more relaxed or not so relaxed. For example, if we speak about direct email, we can wait until one day or 1 week. this could be fair, or could be, well, one day, in 1 week, no, but one day, yes. But if we are speaking about a mobile application, we are speaking about half a second, 500 milliseconds or so. This is the time of response that we should have as an objective. Well, saying that, making or showing you a little bit of how this real-time solutions, what you need to take into account in these real-time solutions, this is what we have done. What we have done is over a cloud, internal cloud system, we have built an infrastructure that is reading from host events. These are changes that are happening in the current account of the customer or in the debit or credit card of the customer. These are the events that may trigger the message. We are also combining this information with information more static. This is in our data warehouse. This is what we call profile information or profile table. So what we are doing is combining this event, this triggering of the event, with the profile of the customer. This profile of the customer is loaded in what we call it's a kind of batch library, it's an in-memory, really, database that make faster the combination of this information, this profile information, with the event, with the information from the event, the business, what we call the business transaction record. Well, once we have all this information, the rules are applied and the message can be triggered. This can be triggered via our communication hub, and we are doing mainly push notifications, and we can also do by SMS, but our first solution is to do it via push notifications. We have also some other solutions, but we are not going to get into them today, that are also based in real time, but this is more related with the personalization of content in the online banking and also in the app. This is another solution that we have already in place, but I think, well, this is a solution that was launched previously, and at this moment we are working with both solutions in parallel, and we are trying to integrate them into under a global strategy for this kind of communications. But right now they are running a bit separately. This is an example of the architecture that we are applying. This is not really the final architecture. It's one of the architectures that we're considering in the middle. I have to say that for running this project, we have two teams. One team is the IT team that is more related with the integration of all these tools, all this tooling. And also we have the data science team that is in my case, and we are more focused on defining the use cases that we are going to apply into this. We also have to do with the IT, with this architecture, we can tell our opinion, but this is more related with IT to define this solution. In our case, as I said, we are more focused in defining the use cases and also applying the predictive models that we are using for our use cases. It's more related with data science, and this could be more related with, can say, with data engineering and big data and solutions and things like that. Here, just to highlight something, the more critical product we could say, or processes we could say, is this application. This is the process that is reading from host system, and this has to be finally configured. We have here to struggle quite hard to get this perfectly in place. Also, a key tool, very important for us, is the memory database. Here is, as I said before, where we have located our profile table with much information of the customer. This much information of the customer can be fed every day or every week or so. As I said, this information we don't need to have it in real time. The real time is this information. At the same time, as we are reading this information in real time, we are storing it in a HDFS system. So we can consult this information, we can query this information, and also we could add this information into our profile table. Another key tool here is Drools. Well, also Kafka, where we are joining all the information, all the we are classifying, we have collecting the topics to identify the events that we need to go on and we don't need to go on. Drools, in this case, is the rules engine, is where we are applying the rules. Consider information that comes from here, from the streaming data, but also from the profile table. And another key point here is how we trigger this. We are triggering this in an internal tool that we have at Deutsche Bank that is called Notification Hub. That is a tool that via API, we are calling it and sending these push notifications. We could also sell SMS, send SMS and emails. We are using this internal tool, but also commercial tools could be used. But by the moment, we are using just this notification hub that is working quite fine for these use cases that we have in place right now. After that, we just wanted to show you a simple example that we have use case. This is related with money outflow. We can detect this money outflow, and we can detect that this money outflow is related with the car insurance. After that, we could say that, or we make these questions to evaluate if the this event deserves or not deserves to send to be sent a message. So we first consider if the customer is having credit issues. That is because with this money inflow for, that comes from car insurance, we are just going to propose the customer defer the payment of this car insurance. That is the reason because we are checking credit issues, we can check if the receipt is over 100 euros because we can defer payments over 100. We are not offering this below 100. We also need to consider if the customer has a credit card because the deferred payments lies over the limit of the credit card. And also we can check or we are checking if the customer has a credit card limit available. Once we have considered all of this, this is considered or this is checked in the rule engine, we send the message, we can send this message. You can receive, you have just received the car insurance receipt. Would you like to defer the payment? Once the customer has received this, he can click over the message and automatically is moved to the login session in the application. And after that, he can go to the fair payment screen. This is an example of the use cases that we have. We are working also in some other kind of more complex use cases. Like for example, I would like to mention the recommender. We have we are developing investment product recommender, and we are going to join this investment product recommender with this real time in the way that if we are able to detect the money inflow, we can run the investment products recommendation system and be able to find the most suitable investment product for this customer where he could apply this money inflow. This is another use case in which we are working right now and has to do also with data science. And finally, we just wanted to show you some key points, what we have found along this the development of this process. As I mentioned, the development of the infrastructure has been done for the IT team. In our case, the data science team is in charge of defining these use cases and defining predictive models or things more related with that, with the application of data more than the setting up of the platform. In this case, we have defined the use cases by ourselves, the data science team, but we have also been working them with the different product managers. To start with the project, to get the budget and so on, what we did is to define a first three or four use cases, do the corresponding business cases to show that this could be profitable. And after that, with these first use cases, we have been showing the solution to the different product managers and we have working all together with them this these new use cases. For the management of the messages that we are sending, we need to consider contact history, we need to consider saturation, we need to consider that the frequency of the messages that we are sending to customers. We can also send personalized content. That means that for the same event, two different customers can receive two different communications. There was another thing I wanted to say here. That history, well, anyway. Also, it's important to consider data governance. We are including this real-time data in a cloud system, in internal cloud system, and we need to be clear with the governance of this data. We have to be clear with are the different roles of the people that is accessing to this data, and also we have to fulfill the global data protection rules. This is something that we have to check with our data protection team. We have to work very close with them, and we have defined with them what are the rules that we need to follow to send the message to the customer or not to send the message to the customer. And as we are going through new use cases, we need also to define new attributes that can be included into this, what we are considering here. Here is this profile table. This is, as I mentioned before, the static data, the batch data. And finally, this is all I wanted to share with you. If you have some questions, I can take them. So
thank you. Thank you very much, Thomas. Yes. So everyone out there watching and listening to this, thank you very much, Thomas. As we've got 45 people kind of currently tuned into this, so I'm sure there must be some questions out there. So pop them in the Q&A tab if you have any. Nothing in there just yet. Thomas, I'll ask you a question. So really interesting presentation. So thank you for that. I think from my experience, one thing that kind of some data and analytics leaders can struggle with is how to get to the point of identifying which use cases are the most relevant to run with, especially when they're trying to get to real-time analytics, right? Because that can be difficult for getting investment and so on and so forth. How did you go through that exercise to kind of figure out where the starting point was?
Do you mean the starting point for the development of the use cases or for defining the use cases more?
Yeah, so how do you identify which is the use case to start with?
Yeah, the use case we start with, the more important ones were those that we have the solution already implemented in the application. For example, the deferred payments is already developing in the application. So this is an easy way to implement it, because it's just the send the push notification, and the push notification goes over the our application. And I mean, it's the customer is addressed to the place where the deferred payment is done. So we have to, what we wanted to do is to prioritize those ones that were already developing the application. Yep. Because in the other side, maybe you need the intervention of an advisor. For example, the one that I mentioned before related with investment pro recommender, you need to go through an advisor.
Yeah, okay, that makes sense. Got a couple of questions coming in now, Tomas. So Vikas has asked, how do you manage data and model drift?
Model drift, what do you mean with model drift, sorry?
I've no idea. Vikas, do you want to expand on your question? In the meantime, Mike, you've asked, will the recording link be sent out? Harsh, I think that is the case, right? He's currently typing back. So, Vikas, do you want to expand on your question? Well, he's just said, how do you manage data and model drift?
Well, I can say that the way that we work with data, I mean, this data is used in streaming. I mean, it's streaming data, and this streaming data via Kafka, it's processes and it's tagged and so on. And also this streaming data is stored in our HDFS platform. So here you can query the data with, I don't know what we are using here, and no SQL, I think we are using here. And in the with the data that we have in batch mode, we have an Oracle system and we are using SQL. And for our models, we are using Python. The models that we are using right now are included in this profile table. We are not using the models in streaming by the moment. We are just using the scores in this profile table.
Yeah. Okay. So Vikas has just expanded and said the kind of degradation of model performance and accuracy.
Yes, this is as we are using the models in a batch mode, let's say, we are taking it outside the real-time solution. We have our own process internally just to check if the models are still being predicting well or not so well. And also here at Deutsche Bank, we have, I don't know how they call it, it's a kind of a platform where we need to register all the models, and we have to follow some rules to make these models to be predictive. I mean, this degradation is done by ourselves, but it's also checked by this global team. This model risk management team, I think, is what we are doing.
Yeah. Okay. There's a couple of more questions coming, Thomas. I'm just obviously conscious of time. We have one person who's asked, what are the KPIs? They've alluded to that they may have they came late, so they may have missed that. But what are kind of the core KPIs that you're working with?
Yeah, we have core KPIs that are more related with the real-time process by itself. That is, for example, the time of response, the milliseconds since the event happens until the customer gets the response. This is one more related with the performance of the platform. And also we have some other KPIs that have more to do with the business performance. This business performance in the case of the deferred payments, what we are monitoring is from the messages that we're sending, who is deferring the payment. Here I can say we have increased from the point of not using it about 40% the deferred payments that we are doing.
Right. Yeah. One more question then for you, Thomas, before we let you go. Someone's asked around data sovereignty and I guess the restriction of the use of cloud services, where you mentioned kind of GDPR and they're talking about who has access to what, but obviously where the data, the storage is of the location is important, right? So,
this GDPR data, we are taking it because of its importance from the host system. We are reading it in real time, but this data is not changing every second, but we are taking this from our host system. This GDPR data, where we have the rights from the customer to be sent or not to be sent the message. We are doing it that way. And the rules to apply that were defined with the data protection team.
Right. Perfect. Well, Thomas, thank you so much. Conscious of time, we need to move on, but thank you very much for that presentation. It was excellent.
Thank you very much.